Yeah, good morning, everyone. So today, this is a very good topic for the webinar, and in collaboration of all three organizations, on behalf of Library Professional Association, Moving World, Society for Information Research and Studies, and Society for Development and People Section. I welcome all the panelists, all the participants to today's webinar. Today we have very eminent speaker from diverse background, and they are very expert in their own field. So today we do have Dr. B.K. Sahu. He is the regional manager in National Research Development Corporation, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India. Another speaker we do have Dr. Soumen Chakravarty. He is expert faculty in copyright and plagiarism and IPR issues. And Dr. Soumen is associated with the SDPA as a director. And we do have Dr. Shantanu Ganguly. Dr. Shantanu Ganguly is fellow in Terry and in the library and the information science. Basically, everyone knows him. He's a very popular person. And he representing Society for Information Research and Studies also. Apart from that, we do have Dr. Ramanand Malviya, President, Library Professional Association. And I request Dr. Malviya to take this webinar for ahead. So Dr. Malviya, please take a charge and go ahead. Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah, Dr. Please, sir.
Hello. Good afternoon to everyone. I, Dr. Ramanand Malviya, President, Library Professional Association, welcome you all on this online webinar, Intellectual Property Management and Ethics in Academic Writing, is organized by SDPA, LPA, and SIRS, New Delhi. The speakers of today's webinar is Dr. Vijay Kumar Sahu, Regional Manager, IPFC and TISC, National Research Development Corporation, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, and Professor Soumen Chakravarty, Visiting Professor at Indian Law Institute and Director, SDPA, New Delhi. The moderator of this webinar is Dr. Shantanu Ganguly, Fellow, Knowledge Management Division, Terry, New Delhi. This topic is very important for authors, and publish intellectual property management and ethics in academic writing. The current intellectual property landscape in India presents moderate challenge for new age libraries. New information technology and increasingly uncertain relationship between the federal government and public universities and the changing landscape of industrial relations make the ownership and exploitation of intellectual property a vital issue of individual academics and institutions. As university turn increasingly to fee-based courses, consultancies, and applied research, they naturally seek to make a better first exploiting intellectual property. Meanwhile, individual academics whose salaries and conditions have been eroded will seek the retained property rights to much for their work as possible. Enterprise bargaining in the universities has only recently begun to grasp the role exploitation and distribution of intellectual property rights, licenses, and royalty. Intellectual property rights are legal rights that protect creation and or invention resulting from intellectual activity in the industrial, scientific, literacy, or artistic field. The most common IPR include patents, copyrights, marks, and trade secrets. Knowledge matters, and so does it protection. The true value of intellectual property rights in the spreading the grassroots innovation, traditional knowledge practices by the empowering the knowledge rich economically poor graduates and traditional knowledge holders. The time IPM, Intellectual Property Management Team, also provides legal assistance to innovators in the negative and negotiation and drafting licensing arrangements, providing legal assistance to innovators in dealing with use of infringement of their IP rights, screening of patents and patent applications based on the Indian traditional knowledge and grassroots innovations, so as to oppose the improper applications granted patents, particularly those dealing with practical entered in the National Patent Register. Library Professional Association, New Delhi, SDPA and SIRS welcomes Dr. Vijay Kumar Sahu and Professor Soumen Chakravarti for accepting our request for sparing his valuable her time. This webinar has drawn widespread attention and an overwhelming response both in the terms of participation and choice of subjects, its current needs and importance for the teachers, researchers, library professionals and students. Now I request Dr. Shantanu Ganguly to proceed.
Over to Ganguly. Thank you, Dr. Malviya. For initiating, I think he has already set the ball rolling. First of all, let me thank LPA, for inviting me to share my thoughts, and also it is introduce you to two stalwarts, and I should not get to speak in front of them. Well, they are their experts in their field. Well, Dr. Sahu is with me, and my old friend Dr. Chakravarti is there. They are the authorities on the subject areas. But before, as Dr. Malviya has already set the ball rolling, but I find quite a good number of, researchers, good students, good number of library information science professional across the globe, they have joined in this particular interesting topic, which is need of the hour. And just to set, since I work with an international think tank knowledge-based organization called TERI, where research is a very important area where we work. I work very closely with the researchers. We have to play a very important pragmatic role as far as the research is concerned. And whenever we are talking about research, automatically two major components come into the purview. One of them is your, when you talk about research, is your IPR, that is intellectual property rights. It is so complicated and it is so vast, then I don't think in just 15, 20 minute or half an hour session that could be phrased. I mean, but yes, some of the indications should be there, because people need to understand the nitty-gritties of the laws and all. In fact, we have in TERI, we have acquired a good number of IPR associated with us who help us from time to time to look into many of the intellectual property rights things, because we developed a lot of patents. We have a lot of IPR related other components also, like from building designs and all, a lot of things are there, which are also part of it. But one of the major component as a knowledge management professionals, we have to play a very, very pragmatic role in this area. Because, and then let me tell you friends that I do a very specific program for my entire 1200 people, 1200 researchers who are associated with me in TERI. I call that program, it is every month I take up that program, where it is called, I call it as a research literacy program. And one of the important component, I mean, it is a kind of a hand-holding I do with all my researchers, that what you should know. You are doing a research, you are bringing out a product, you are bringing out a service, you are creating an impact for the society. But on the other hand, you should know two things. One, what are the legal implications involved in it? Number one. And number two, what are the regulation and the framework? It is extremely important to understand these two major areas. And in many, copyright has got it is a very, very complicated area. Still at this stage, Shoman is there. Shoman will be able to tell you more about the things. But we make a lot of mistakes. And we, bank upon on the intellectual, for this particular thing, we always bank upon the IPR lawyers or our advisors for getting their clearances. So the topic which we are going to discuss today, it is enormous. And it is enormous. It cannot be encapsulated in such half an hour or 1 hour program. But still, at least people have shown interest to come and join and learn and listen. Only thing you have to not to hear, but to listen. And listening means there is a difference between a listening and hearing. That listening means it has to go inside. And it should create a kind of a vibrancy in yourself that what you are listening to it. Just touch upon a couple of things I just want to share with you, with generally a program which has, this is just a, I'm sure all of you can see my screen here, just giving you an overview of an academic integrity, we call it, where one of the important component today, a message, and the most important message is honesty is the foundation of good academic and research work. Let me tell you, I can see there is a large number of researchers are there. But please remember, and honesty is the best policy, and honesty can give birth to a good academic and research work. Whether you are working on a problem set, you are working on a lab report or a project or a paper, or you are avoiding engaging in plagiarism, unauthorized collaboration, cheating, facilitating academic dishonesty, and this happens. Knowingly, unknowingly, it happens. I think what is in organizations like ours, we do a large number of projects. We have a large number of research papers publishing. We are doing put a lot of things on social media, lot of dissertation and theses, lot of lab reports. Let me tell you about social media. We keep on putting a lot of pictures in the social media. But how many of you know you cannot put a pictures like that? In fact, the pictures which I am using there, I have taken from a licensed database. All these pictures were taken. Even each and every image, each and every, the write-up which you are taking, it cannot just come under fair use. People always have a misnomer about fair use. Fair use not like that. It is beyond that. We need to understand those nitty-gritties. But one thing I would, it's a caution or a caveat you can say, please do an organized research. Please don't afraid of it, but adopt a systematic process. You have an access to resources, do a proper citation and referencing, give credit to the aspirant. If you have taken something from someone, please take it from them. Give him an appropriate credit. Otherwise, it is very difficult. And develop a culture not to plagiarize. So that's a very, very important thing. So just setting the ball rolling, I am just giving you few components in this. And now I have with me the very two powerful speakers. I have one, Dr. Shoman Chakraborty. He is a legal analyst and an academic by profession. He's a renowned scholar and writes on various aspects of WTO, TRIPS, and intellectual property rights. He's an advocacy strategist on human rights. Shoman has been teaching in various colleges and universities for several decades now, and so far has 100 of research-based articles, around 10 books in the credit, and he's a very well-known author. Dr. Shoman travels extensively in and around India and also visits the countries across the continents to present the papers and participate in academic discourse and consultations. He functions as an honorable director for the Society for Social Development and People's Planning. I have with me also Dr. B.K. Sahu, who is a well-known figure in the field. He's a regional manager and head, NRDC, Intellectual Property Facilitation Center, IPFC, UN WIPO. I'm sure he must be an authority on the WIPO area. He is also a person from NRDC. We also work. It's a part of DSIR because I do a lot of projects with DSIR. So I know NRDC's contribution into that. He earned his MSc, MPhil, and PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru University on intellectual property rights and technology capabilities. with special reference to India. And Dr. Sahu is heading the NRTC, that is MOSME, an Intellectual Property Facilitation Center, United Nations, WIPO, Technology Innovation Support Center at Vishakhapatnam, and also the NRTC of Government of India. So, and he is also during the 12th Global IP Convention at Vigyan Bhavan for the promotion of IP and innovation in India and abroad. He was one of the, you know, recipient of the Global IP Convention Awards. So, and he is considered as one of the 100 influential IP leader from India by World IP Forum for the year 2017. And he was invited as a keynote speaker of United Nations also on IP innovations and educational curriculum. So with this, I would request Dr. Sahu to please initiate in the session, and followed by Dr. Somen Chakraborty. So over to Dr. Sahu, please.
Thank you, Dr. Ganguly. It is a privilege for me. Good morning, all of you. Thank you, Dr. Malviya. And I'm grateful to Dr. Somen Chakraborty, the president of SBA. And it is an honor for me to join this in this program. And last 2 months, we have been conducting this kind of webinar. After 26th of April, World IP Day, we are doing series of program in with various institutions, universities, and the industry at large also, when we talked about knowledge management, knowledge generation, knowledge protection, and knowledge sharing. So as you are aware, that intellectual property plays a very important role in the 21st century of knowledge economy. So I'm grateful to all of you. Good morning, all of you. And I have a presentation. I'll just like to share the presentation. And thank you, Professor Ganguly, for giving me an opportunity and also inform about our organizational credential, my credential to the August gathering here. I'm grateful to you, sir. And I hope my PPT is visible to all of you. Dr. Ganguly, my PPT is visible.
Yes, sir. Very much visible, sir. And your audio is very clear. Thank okay. you, sir. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So already Dr. Ganguly has informed about me, my organizational credential, and my topic already given by Dr. Malviya. I'm grateful to Dr. Malviya. So when we talked about intellectual property, particularly on patent, trademark, and copyright under the digital economy and the challenges what we are facing at this time, COVID-19, this is one of the biggest challenge the whole community is now suffering, and we have to mitigate it. And for that, we need innovation. Innovation is nothing but the value creation. And innovation can change the game. And the innovation must be also accessible, adaptable, and available to the people of the society. So at the outset, I would like to pay my homage to Amar Jawan, those who are giving life for the country. And as a citizen of India, and that is our ultimate respect to the country as an Indian, Jai Hind. And I think in this forum also, I would like to request you how we can mitigate the challenge as an Indian at past. So this is my humble request to all of you. And certainly, I'll go to my topic. So friends, when we are talking about, you are all the library professional here, and today the knowledge must have to manage, and knowledge must have to acknowledge. And there must be a knowledge, that knowledge must transfer from the lab to the market. And we have been talking about mind to market, lab to land. So when we talked about Atmanirbhar Bharat, that is the only thing we can transfer that knowledge, that knowledge which can mitigate the challenge what we are facing at this time. And that knowledge can make the difference to the people and give the people a accessible, available, and adaptable innovation. And that's we are talking about knowledge management and knowledge transfer. So Prime Minister of India always talked about innovate, patent, produce and prosper. And why we have been talking about intellectual property. And you know, we are part of the WTO, we are part of the TRIPS, and you also know, as a knowledge manager, innovation officer of various university, you know that turmeric was patented in US, basmati rice was patented in US. So point is that we are not going to protect our own process and product, somebody will protect. And we have seen the challenges, how we fought that case before USPTO to mitigate that challenge. So friends, since we are part of the TRIPS agreement and the WTO, we have already compliance the WTO norm as far as intellectual property management in the country is concerned. So certainly this patent system adds the value to the fuel of interest of the fire of genius. And it doesn't mean that intellectual property is a monopoly right, yes. But at the same time, you are all aware that some of the cases of accessibility, availability in India, we have an excellent framework of accessibility and availability of intellectual property for the public health and the people of this country. We have some TRIPS flexibility. So friends, we have Make in India, Digital India, Startup India, Skill India. Now the notion of self-reliance India is going on. So when we talked all this flagship program, certainly intellectual property plays an important role. And today you are aware that in the global economy, China is number one in terms of filing of patent. That country in 2005, it was 10th position, but today it is number one position. That means in the monopoly right, the country has taken its position in the global economy in terms of the protectionism. Since we are part of, please keep in mind, we are part of the WTO. And as we have compliance WTO norm and we have a vibrant ecosystem of intellectual property, as Dr. Ganguly talked about. So when we talked about Indian innovation ecosystem, Indian IPR ecosystem, certainly I talked about where we stand and what is the problem. And we have certainly a big challenge today, that is United Nations Sustainable Development Goal. And that development goal we have to achieve by 2030, where accessibility is most important for all these things. And for that, we need to achieve innovation infrastructure framework. Then can only we can mitigate this challenge. So certainly intellectual property plays a very important role in the knowledge economy. And you are aware that for any MSME and startup, navigating new business to the knowledge society is intellectual property plays a very important role. We have Startup India, we have Make in India, many startup, more than 10 lakh startup already registered in the Startup India mission. That means that startup are planning to come out with some new process and product to the society so that country will able to get it. The country will avail the indigenous technology when we talked about Atmanirbhar Bharat. So now we need to mitigate our own challenge, what we are facing from our own process and product generation. We must not depend on import of technology. You are aware about that. Indian technology dependency on import is very, very high, and we must have to strengthen intellectual property system, because intellectual property system or IP system gives accessibility and also benefit sharing to the author, inventor, and also the producer. So that is the role of intellectual property in the 21st century knowledge economy. We must have to understand. It is a monopoly right. Who has the monopoly right? The creator has the monopoly right. The author has the monopoly right. The inventor has the monopoly right over his invention and also originality of the process and product. Dear sir, as you know, the country is still now having the challenging time as far as the IP violation. You know, you are coming from a very institutional ecosystem. Many of the university in the country and many of the leader of the university caught in plagiarism, IPR violation. And also, since IPR is a legal right, there is a legal challenges on that we must have to understand. And that ultimately certainly lose the credibility of the institution and individual. So in innovation and intellectual property is very, very important, and you are the people who are managing innovation of the institution at institutional level, and how that innovation plays a very important role, and what is the accessibility, availability, and affordability to the student and the various stakeholder of the knowledge economy. So you have the decade of the innovation. We have a lot of number of institutional ecosystem. Government of India has come out. We have National Intellectual Property Policy 2016 came out. National IPR policy has created a benchmark and the ecosystem for protection of intellectual property, so that any individual inventor, author, creator can protect over his and her intellectual property right in the form of patent, trademark, copyright, design, semiconductor integrated circuit layout design, geographical indication of goods, plant varieties and farmer rights. These all are the different intellectual properties, but we have compliance from the WTO. And also this decade has also a number of institutions came out. You might be knowing we have a Atal Innovation Mission. The basic objective of Atal Innovation Mission is to inculcate innovation at institutional level. We have the program of Ministry of Human Resource, MHRD Innovation Cell. Now every institution have a IIC, Institution Innovation Council. So point is that these are the ecosystem, strengthen the national innovation ecosystem, and also create ecosystem for entrepreneurship. And today we need entrepreneur as far as if we need the manufacturing ecosystem in the country. And you know, in India, manufacturing ecosystem is very, very poor if we compare with other country. So friends, today, when we talked about solving the problem or the mitigating the challenge, you know, the whole community or the society now is under pandemic. We need innovation to mitigate this challenge. We need tracing, we need testing, and we need treating kids for this pandemic. For that, we must have to bring innovation, and we must have to think out of box. And we must not go for only publication. We must think for solving the problem at our own place, and that innovation leads to prosperity and the national growth. And that is certainly make the difference in our society. UGC has asked all the university to come out the intellectual property credit course curriculum, so that students should know, faculty should also know about the intellectual property protection, management, ecosystem, and also benefit sharing of invention created by that faculty. Because in the country, you know, there are around 800 universities, more than 11,000 engineering colleges, more than 40,000 general colleges are there. In that, because this is the largest talented manpower where the knowledge is there, and we must have to protect that knowledge. We must have to acknowledge the knowledge. That is the role of intellectual property. That ethics and practice must be there as far as the intellectual property protection is concerned. So we have National Innovation and Startup Policy from MHRD, so that is the guiding framework for higher education institution to create a start job. Getting a job, it is very difficult, and it is a well-known factor, you know also. So how we can create a job? That's the startup, and innovation can make the difference to the society, and that is very, very important today. We have Institutional Innovation Council to inculcate idea, creativity, business opportunity in the institutional level, and that ecosystem will be the ornament to the society where academia-industry collaboration is there. For that, we need to build a skill set, and that skill set can make the difference in the society. I talked about National IPR Policy, and that policy objective was to Creative India, Innovative India, and we have the 8 to 9 framework or objective. One is capacity building on intellectual property, enforcement of intellectual property, commercialization of intellectual property, and education of intellectual property. So these are the objective of the Government of India, where we must have to strengthen the ecosystem, and ecosystem must be collaborative, cooperative, and connective must be there, as far as the management of intellectual property, and also there must be a benefit sharing of intellectual property and incentive for the creator of the intellectual property. So let me tell you about, since I talked about policy aspect also, I'll certainly give you some of the example how we have helped to individual inventor, individual scientist, individual professor, individual student who have created an IPR. We protect their IPR free of cost. NRDC bear cost for filing the patent, trademark and design, copyright, all these things. And also, because that is a right of the individual who is the creator. And that they need that kind of ecosystem to protect their IP. And you have seen in the case of turmeric. Turmeric was patented. Basmati rice was patented. The history says if we are not going to protect, somebody will protect it. So, as I told you, there are innovation plays a very important role in the knowledge economy. When we talked about technological innovation, patents is patents, copyright plays a very important role. And these are the various type of intellectual property what we'll be discussing in next half an hour. So, friends, you have seen one of the movie called Three Idiots. And you know, two issues from you might have observed from that movie. Between the one of the debatable issue was between the controversy between Vidhu Vinod Chopra and Chetan Bhagat about the issues of the copyright. And in that movie also, you have seen how student is out of box, making the difference. And today we need that. We must not go to traditional kind of ecosystem. We have to be out of box to mitigate the challenge. How the character of Hunsung Wanglu, who has you know the his story also in recent time, he has been talking about manufacturing innovation in the country at this present time when there is a strategic volatile situation in the border. So point is that how individually we can make the difference, and we must believe small is beautiful. And if you are making the difference at our own place, at our own level, certainly that will give strength to the national level and we can make the difference. So when you talk about innovation, many institutions have in recent time came out process and product to mitigate the COVID-19. So that innovation can make the difference where the industry will come forward to manufacture that product, and where there is a job creation, value creation, and also national growth, because the product is indigenous product. And that is the dream of Mahatma Gandhi, indigenization or Swadeshi, when we talked about innovation. So friends, I'll give you some example how we are giving transferring the indigenous technology to the startup and MSME as far as the IP protected technology, because the owner, the inventor has done the work, because it is his creativity and it is his right and it is his invention, and he must have to get the benefit out of it. And that is the real role of intellectual property. And we have recent time transfer many technology to the MSME and startup, and that MSME and startup has created the value creation to the society by providing this new technology. So our job, our NRDC role, is to sensitize R&D institution and industry in technology commercialization. And you are aware of Controller General of Patent, Trademark and Design under Ministry of Commerce and Industry, who grant the patent, design, trademark, GI, copyright, semiconductor integrated circuit layout design, and also plant varieties and farmer right, and that is with Ministry of Agriculture, PPB, FRA. These are the institutional ecosystem of IPR ecosystem in the country who are granting the intellectual property. So friends, I'll certainly talk about COVID-19. What we did, NRDC in recent time came out with a compendium of Indian technology combating COVID-19, tracing, testing and treating. And this technology now we are transferring to many industries, and this technology developed by our national labs, DRDO, ICR, ICMR, CSR. Now we are transferring this technology know-how to the industry for manufacturing, so that they can come out the new process and product to mitigate this that challenge. Their intellectual property is that role of intellectual property is with the inventor and the institution, and there is certainly a benefit sharing once the technology commercialized to the industry, and there is a benefit sharing of intellectual property. We also, in recent time, call for the proposal for maturing lab-scale technology so that ideas would come. And that idea is the new idea, and that is the patentable idea where we can process, file a patent, make a prototype, and also certainly commercialize that product for the benefit of the people. So friends, when we talked about intellectual property, we must have to understand where we stand as far as the Global Innovation Index and India position. And you know, in due course of time, India has remarkably increased the rank over the years. Now we are 52 ranks globally as far as the innovation is concerned. So in the Global Innovation Index, we must have to come out with a ecosystem where all stakeholders should get benefit. Then only we can be a globally number, position as far as the innovation management, innovation and protection and innovation commercialization is concerned. So this is when we talked about intellectual property patent. You just have a look where China and the position of the India, and it has been reported that in India, the filing of patent, although day by year by year there is an increase, but if we compare with China, Korea and Taiwan and US, our patent application or the protection is very, very low if we compare with this country. So friends, internationally, as I talked to you about the protection is because in the WTO, protectionism is there in the trade and how we are protecting our indigenous process, product, new invention. You see, internationally, in 2005, US was number one. But if you see today, China is number one international patent application by a single country. So this is a paradigm shift, how they have developed their economy and the monopoly particularly. As you know, patent is nothing but the novelty, inventiveness, and industrial applicability of the invention as per the Patent Act, the definition of the patent. So point is that those countries who have the monopoly, who have the protectionism, they will rule the game of the society as far as the technology export and import is concerned. And this is the challenging time we must have to understand to strengthen the ecosystem of innovation at our institutional level so that we can make the difference. So innovation plays a very important role and long-term health of the ecosystem, and we must need a healthy root system, and that healthy root system is nothing but the creativity, innovation. And you know, software in India, piracy of software is there rampant, and you knows very well than me about software piracy, and because of that only we have kept a priority watch list called Special 301 provision over India by the US department. We need skill set, we need patent, we need ideas to mitigate the challenge, then only we can have a excellent root system to leverage the innovation in the country. And innovation is very, very important. We need to have that. So IPR is the biggest challenge today. When we talked about Industry 4.0, artificial intelligence, IoT, blockchain, when we talked about research funding, because you are aware that research funding in India, 75% research come from publicly funded organizations like DST, DBT, METI, and other department of government of India. So this is a funding research. And you know, many infringement issues came in last 6-7 years. Many of the university vice chancellor caught in plagiarism. Many of the institution came. Imitation, one of the biggest challenges today. And India is the 12th mega diverse country in the world. Many biological process, product and process and plant are there. And there is issues of excess of plant genomic research. We have National Biodiversity Authority for regulating such IPR issues there. So Special 301 provision, already you know that. Public and private sector research in India, public sector research is, funding is more as compared to private sector research. These many more are the issues as far as IPR in India. These are the challenges today. We have to create the ecosystem for that. And we need the vibrant ecosystem so that university, the way we talked about Oxford is coming out with the COVID-19 vaccine, same way we must talk about Indian university also come out with some such kind of invention and innovation to mitigate the challenge. And for that, we need a IP ecosystem IP policy at our institutional level, university level, so that the benefit sharing should be there, incentives should be there to the research and as well as the management, those who are managing intellectual property. Certainly, you people are managing intellectual property at your institutional level and in an innovative way in terms of your the library information or software and many more. You play a very important role as far as the intellectual property management at institutional level, but there must be a benefit sharing mechanism as far as research commercialization, research consultancy. You know, research consultancy, there are various kind of research consultancies today. There is funding research, there is collaborative research, there is contract research. So all these are there where intellectual property plays a very important role, because ownership, who has invented, who has created, the way you come out with those many program and many software program to mitigate such managing databases, that means you are the programmer and you must have to protect the copyright, because that is your creativity and that is the originality today. And the originality is very, very important, and that's the knowledge must be acknowledged, and knowledge must have to be protected at this 21st century knowledge economy. So IPR, the biggest challenge opportunity is that you will get a, if your concept is clear, your concept is novel, your concept is have an industrial potential, certainly under the Startup India mission, many people, many startup leader has got the funding from various organization, and they are getting a angel funding, seed funding to coming out the new process and product to the country. And that's the role of IPR, challenge and opportunity in the country. And we at NRDC plays a very important role in the knowledge economy as far as the protection of intellectual property of any institution, any university, any individual and startup is concerned. We protect all IP free of cost. We bear the cost for the same, and also we try to commercialize that intellectual property so that country will get an innovative product and process, and the leader, the person who have developed, is certainly a leader, and he will make the difference in bringing new innovation, invention to the society, and also benefit sharing, because inventor must get the benefit over his creativity if there is a commercialization. And you are aware that intellectual property is an intangible asset, and government has an excellent policy on that. Now framework is there also, ecosystem is also there. So that intangible asset may be a tangible asset when you transfer to any companies or industry for manufacturing. That's the intellectual property opportunity in the country. So intellectual and Saraswati together, as far as the academia industry collaboration is concerned, because university institution are the place of the Saraswati. If we bring industry there, and if there is a process transfer of mind to the market, certainly there is a intellectual property protection, and also the original product will go to the market and people will get the benefit, and also the creator will also get the benefit over his creativity, and that is the benefit of intellectual property. And intellectual property policy should be there in the institutional level, at the university level, so that incentive opportunity will be there, collaborative opportunity will be there, incubation opportunity will be there, because IPR has considered an intangible asset and original invention process and product. So we need industry academia collaboration for improvement of the quality of academics, and you are aware of that. And also we are very much aware of the situation today. If you not bring skill set as for the industry demand, we are not going to mitigate as far as the livelihood of our own people are concerned. So we must have to change our attitude as for the demand of the time, and that's we are going through, friends, as far as the intellectual property in the 21st century. When we talked about the challenges, what we are facing today is nothing but the COVID-29, and we need innovation, we need vaccine for that, and time to time people are doing R&D and coming out with some solution, but at the same time, we as an Indian must have to come some kind of solution. We must not depend on other. We must create value at our own place, at our own organization. That is the organizational credibility today in the knowledge economy. How we are creating the value in the society, that's very, very important today. Let me tell you a small example of technology transfer and innovation and intellectual property, since I have some time. Recently, one of the inventor of scientists has developed a recycling of plastic waste to tile. And you are aware that how plastic waste create a problem in the environment. And we transfer that technology to, I think, 12 startup and MSME in the country, in the 13 state. And that is the value creation. There is a recycling of plastic waste, and these are the tile, and these are the tile can be useful for the floor making. And that's the role of a leader and the startup leader and MSME who can make the difference. And also the creator of that process, new process, the inventor or scientist must benefit out of it, and that is his intellectual property. And that is the credibility, that is the supremacy, that is the benefit. After your retirement also, you can get a royalty over your creativity, because people are using it, and at the same time, as a creator, you are getting the incentive. And that's the role of intellectual property. And many people, I certainly agree, many people may ask, there is a monopoly right. Yes, there is a monopoly right. But in case of national emergency, in case of health emergency, government has the provision. And you have seen in the case of one of the cases of the cancer medicine, India, government of India given the compulsory licensing. So in the public health, under the TRIPS, we have flexibility of parallel import. We have the flexibility of the compulsory license. That is also some of the instrumental measure are there to mitigate such challenge. So in recent time, we also transfer the PCR detection kits to one of the startup. That startup today has came out with the corona detection kits and making the difference at the society. And that the knowledge generation, knowledge protection, and knowledge management and knowledge transfer we talked about. So friends, everyone, you know, because you are many learned people, Professor Shobhan Chakraborty is there, Dr. Suman Ganguly, and many of the experts are there. They might be not agree as far as but why we are going to protect as a IP. Let me tell you, as I already told you, and you are aware that also, we are part of the WTO. And under the Article 27 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, 1948, everyone has the right to protection of the moral and material interest resulting from any scientific, literary, and artistic production of which he is the author. And everyone has the right to share the scientific advancement and its benefit. This is a clear cut. The policy at international level, at UN level, we must have to protect our intangible asset, intellectual output created by us, because that is our dignity and that is our credibility in the market. So intellectual property is nothing but the creation of the mind of such invention, literary work, artistic work, design, symbol, name, and image used in commerce. And there are various type of intellectual property. You know, we are IPR. Our ecosystem is very excellent, transparency, online, and in 24/7, you can protect your IP in terms of patent, copyright, trademark, design, semiconductor integrated circuit layout design, geographical indication of goods, confidential information that's trade secret, and also protection of plant varieties and farmer right. All are the IPR, and it is legal in nature, limited in time, and territorial in application. So friends, we must have to create and we must have to protect. And if there is some protection, and we must have to exploit that protection in terms of commercial process and product, so that we can get a new product or innovative product or indigenous product. That's the role of IPR in knowledge creation. So why you should file a patent? It is a recognition, it is a reward, and also it is an incentive to license your technology patent to a company, and also anyone can start a new company as a startup. And most important is protection against imitators. That's very, very important today. What can be patented? Any process, apparatus, device, machines, chemicals, drugs, food and their composition, biological process with human intervention, biological product can be patentable. So we must have to, whatever the funding we are getting, we must do the research. And if there is new development, we must protect, because that is our creativity and that is our right. And that is our right we have got in the WTO system to protect, and we must protect and also transfer that technology, and we can get a tangible benefit over it. and this is the commercial exploitation of intellectual property. So what is not patentable? I think I must not kill the time. Some of the other eminent speakers are there. So friends, copyright, literary work, artistic work, painting, all copyright issues. Computer program cannot be protected as a patent. It can be protected as a copyright. And also presentation of information is not patentable. Traditional knowledge is not patentable. Best that you have seen the case of turmeric. And we fought that case before USPTO, and we provided the traditional knowledge of that turmeric. That was the one of the Islamic literature of 1848. We presented before that, and that patent on turmeric was revoked to the University of Mississippi. We won that case finally. So point is that we must know what is patentable and what is not patentable as per the Indian Patent Act. So copyright issues, you know, you are, backbone, those who are managing the software and also information about the institution, about the library information is concerned. And that is nothing but the innovation management you are doing. So at this digital economy, computer program, database, multimedia, reproduction, distribution, communication, public, all these things, intellectual property plays a very important role. Copyright can be registered. Anyone who have developed any artistic work, painting, literary work, can protect their copyright because it is a legal right in nature. You can protect online. So in the digital economy, all this technology plays a very important role as far as the copyright is concerned. E-books, musical, artistic work, today e-books become a very, very opportunity, and also online education is going on. And right now also I'm sitting in the laptop of my daughter who was in online class, and I requested her to sit here. So my name Divyasri Sahu is coming, but I'm Dr. B.K. Sahu. This is my daughter's name. So friends, these are the digital economy which plays a very important role in the paradigm shift of new age of communication, computer programs, sound recording, films, performance right, all are copyrighted issues. At the same time, there is a fair dealing. Any research, review, news reporting, and we have seen in the case of one of the litigation at Delhi University, Ramesh Photo Studio, about the litigation between Chief Oxford University Press, Francis Taylor, and also Cambridge University as far as copyright violation. So, and also the biggest decision given by the High Court, Honorable High Court, also you know that. And but at the same time, what we are losing as far as copyright infringement in the country, you will be surprised. The total revenue loss in copyright in India, you know, in India is 180 billion annually, and also particularly in new movie industry, there is a loss of 3.6 billion, and we are losing around 60,000 annual job because of the illegal activities and copyright violation in the country. And this is the report of FICCI and KPMG 2017 report about how copyright significantly help in the economic growth of the country. All the I'll certainly talk about my and also there is also another intellectual property that is on geographical indication of goods. That plays a very important role in the knowledge economy, and as far as the goods and product originated from a particular place, particular quality, particular brand, and that is nothing but the geographical indication of goods. The way Darjeeling tea, Pachampali kat, Banarasi sari, Kullu shawl, Pachampali kat, Odisha rasagola, and Tirupati Laddu, all these products must be protected as a GI product, because the communities, those who are depending livelihood and this quality they are giving, the quality must be recognized GI, and under the GI, under the DPIIT, we must have to protect, so that sensitize our people, those communities who can get the right over their new product and process is concerned. Government of India has a women scientist scheme. You might be knowing TIFAC run this program, is called Women Kiran program. As a women scientist, they are now playing a very important role in the country as far as intellectual property protection, IP drafting, patent litigation. So women scientists plays a great role, and every institution should have a woman scientist. We got training of 1 year under the support of the DST under the TIFAC. They work as a woman scientist and do the job of IPR services in the country. So trademark is, you know, any sign, word, letter, number, drawing, picture, anything, that logo, that brand, that is nothing but the trademark. And that trademark, we recognize the products or of the goods, and that's appeal to our eye, and we use it. And that's the role of trademark in the knowledge economy, how trademark protected, we must know. And trademark plays a very important role of the brand of the company, quality of the company also. And as a consumer, we give the mark and we take it, that product, in our heart when we are using many trademark evening. And this is nothing but the role of intellectual property in our day-to-day life. So this is water bottle. This water bottle, certainly you are not going to drink it. But if I'll give you this water bottle, ultimately you'll drink it. That means the trust will come, the brand will certainly make the difference. So that is nothing but the trademark that plays an important role in the knowledge economy, in the trade economy. And that's the product and process we recognize, and that's the value we give to in the market. So the trademark is one of the forms of the intellectual property. And in the single product, you will get many intellectual property, and that intellectual properties plays a very important role in our day-to-day life. So there is a paradigm shift through innovation. We need innovation and value creation, and that value creation makes a difference. And many university and has plays a very important role. And I'll certainly talk about item number 8, the Sri Chitra Institute of Medical Science, who have many patent, and also these are the top 10 institution university who have filed the patent for the year 2017-18. But I would like to certainly talk about Sri Chitra Institute of Medical Science. They have come out with the solution for COVID-19. So this is the innovation, and this is the value creation, and making the difference at this time. So our institution and university must come out with some kind of solution so that the country will get benefit, people will get benefit, and certainly there is a recognition of that institution in the knowledge economy. So there must be a IPM cell, intellectual property management cell, in all the university and institution, so that it can be review, monitor the publication, student thesis, books by faculty, research project. There must be IP policy, so that IP policy can be the Bible of the institution. Everybody will respect, leverage, and also have the right over the creativity, and also protect the right. And also there should be a benefit sharing as far as the commercialization of intellectual property is concerned. And scout for R&D collaboration, facilitate technology transfer, manage IP portfolio and incubation process. And you are aware that Government of India, under the Department of Science and Technology, many institutions, there is an incubation center you can develop, and government can support you through the NSTDB, National Science Technology Entrepreneurship Board, or the many, if you are a technical organization related to biotechnology, Government of India, BIRAC, many funding are there, many grants are there, MEDI is giving TIDE program, and that ultimately strengthen your institution, and also you are going to create a value and industry collaboration, and making that value and bringing that value to the market so that people will get benefit out of it. So there must be a revenue sharing if there is a commercialization of intellectual property, so that the inventor, scientist, faculty, and the research scholar must get the benefit out over their creativity once if it is commercialized. I think Dr. Jha is looking at me. I understand, sir, that I have to skip the time. So these are some of the IP we have commercialized of various university. I need to skip the case of biopiracy. I already talked about the patenting on turmeric. And we have a traditional knowledge digital library, so that traditional knowledge must not be protected by patent. So we have a traditional knowledge digital library. Also, for a librarian, you must look into some of the aspect related to emergence of IP aspect for the digital economy. I must have talked about something about library. You must see when you are managing any IT information or software, you must have to see all these things as far as your digital technology is concerned, because IP right is very, very punitive, penalties are there. So IP manager or the library and information officer must look into this aspect as far as the emergence of this printed and e-resource and copyright resources, managing the digital resource and digitalized manuscript Menis Group. There are many opportunity and also challenge for you to mitigate such kind of activity as far as the IPR ownership is concerned. So what we do as a university, government of India organization, we go to all university institution and connect to them so that we can take some knowledge from their mind to the market. And we do all kind of this, all necessary program like IP protection, market survey, licensing of technology, incubation service, angel funding, all this thing we do and transfer the technology to the entrepreneur so that the creator will also get the benefit once the technology transfer goes to the entrepreneur. And ultimately, every year the royalty will come and the inventor will get the benefit over his creativity. So this, from ideas to product, we play a very important role. And at this time, when we talked about Industry 4.0, blockchain plays a very important role today as far as the transparent, incorruptibility, and immutable issues are there. We help each university's ecosystem, TBI, and also we do all capacity building. And also we recognize the individual innovator, inventor creativity. We give national innovation awards every year in the, by organizing Innovate India. We give budding innovator to giving them awards. We transfer the technology, indigenous technology, and to the startup and MSME. And we also do capacity building program as far as intellectual property and innovation management is concerned. I sit at Visakhapatnam. You are most welcome to discuss with me for any kind of support, because as a Government of India institution, it is my basic fundamental duty to serve you better in a very better way, excellent way, affordable way, adaptable way, and innovative way. So friends, the problem is never how to get a new innovative thought into our mind, but how to get the old one out. It is very, very essential and important at this juncture. Thank you all of you. God bless you all. Jai Hind, Bande Mataram. My mobile number, email ID is there. Anyone who can have a idea to protect that idea, and also we need to protect that idea, you can keep in touch with me. My mobile number, email ID is there. Thank you, Professor Ganguly, Professor Chakrabarty, and also Professor Malviya, for giving me opportunity. And I am grateful that I met Dr. Anand Jha today. I met him last time at SDA when I was in Delhi. So thank you, all of you. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sahu. And we are always blessed with your words when we listen to you on this topic. And your presentation is fantastic. It's very knowledgeable. I hope all the participants will get benefited about this. Definitely, be clear about the patent, copyright, trademark, whatever they have in their mind related to this topic, they must be clear. But apart from that, I will provide the recording of the complete your session. So that is already after the session, we just uploaded on the YouTube and share the link with everyone. So not an issue. And apart from that, if they have any some questions, and then definitely I receive all the questions and send it to you by mail. And I hope you will reply accordingly. So thank you so much, Dr. Saul, for your kind words in this form. So now we have the another speaker, Professor Somin Chakrabarty, that already introduced with the Dr. Ganguly. And Dr. Chakrabarty with us, and I request him to please share his views related to the today's topic. Dr. Chakrabarty.
Hello, listening to
yes. me? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's a very clear, sir, audible.
Okay. Should I start?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Fine.
Please, sir, go ahead. Thank you, sir.
So at the very outset, I must express my deep gratitude to LPA for taking enormous effort to keep the library professionals and other scholars busy in last 2 months, very difficult time of this century. By taking them to a lot of subjects, I believe they have taken to a ocean of knowledge during this time. And I'm fortunate that I have also come to this platform to share some of my thoughts. My presentation is very brief, okay? And it can go even in the story telling, I can avoid this APT also. My topic is, is like that you know, I am from legal profession, so I could practice in the law, in the court also, but I teach. And occupationally, I do another thing, that when two academic persons are engaged in unnecessary legal disputes, and when they are ready to move towards the judiciary for a legal redressal of their problem, I come on the way and say that, don't go, I am here, okay? And please listen to me before going to the court. And that way, you know, I try to save their money, at least, you know, whatever possible, their anxiety and their time, because court, from the distance, like Bollywood, you know, it looks like very colorful, but when you enter into that, then you become a Sushant Rajput. Okay, so therefore, I try to stop them going into the very complicated, complex judicial procedure. Now, why I do it? Okay, it's very you know, simple reason, because academics have a lot of other things to do, and they cannot waste their time in this kind of litigations and, you know, this kind of wasting of money. And a lot of mental arises, it will be reducing their productivity. Okay. Now, today I am discussing in that context ethics in academic writing and copyright. Okay. What I mean to say, you know, there is always some ethics involved in academic activity. I'm giving recently, just before the COVID lockdown started in February. Our HRD minister in a parliamentary question answer session said that three eminent professors of some universities in India have been suspended. Suspended for what? For plagiarism. And they have set up an inquiry committee, and that inquiry committee have found at least three instances where they have done it, you know, this kind of plagiarism, you know, which is not permissible. So therefore, they have been suspended. Now, there are many, many others. Okay, this is not the only examples. I'm just giving examples where very reputed persons and people working in reputed universities are also involved in plagiarism. For example, V.S. Rajput. He was the vice chancellor of Kumaon University. And he was then got an acquisition of plagiarism. What he did, he quickly transferred this liability to a, you know, a junior professor, assistant professor who was recently recruited. He said that this is his work, I am innocent. But then pressure mounted, then, you know, recall a lobbying started, and finally V.S. Rajput had to admit, no, it was a criminal offense done by him, and he had to resign finally. Another example, that Deepak Pental, the 63 years old Vice Chancellor of Delhi University. He had to spend one night in police custody, not in jail, but under police custody. What he did, his own colleague, a professor in the Department of Environment, that is Professor Sarathis, an article he published in his own name. So when it was, you know, came to the limelight, it was an accusation, an FIR, and he had to spend at least one night. But now imagine, people like Deepak Pental or V.S. Rajput have not got this kind of position, you know, just what do you call, casually. That means they have been consistently serious students, serious scholars, and serious professors for a long, long time. Even those people, when they get this kind of reputation at the fag end of their professional life, it almost ruins their reputation, their further prospect. Giving, you know, I can give 20, you know, days after days I can give this kind of, but I'm giving a couple of them, which will be interesting for you. There are another called, you know, from what do you call, Venkateshwara University of Tirupati, is a Patiyam Chiranjeevi. He got more than 70 papers published within 3 years' time, that is 2004 to 2007. 70 good academic publication within 30 months' time. In spite of having your regular classes, regular other activities, almost an impossible task. So therefore, definitely eyebrows, okay, they raised the doubt, okay, that how come he is doing it? And it was exposed that he has been just doing cut and paste and plagiarism. Just imagine that 70 publications, reputation has been demolished in one go. Another person in 1995, R. Vijayaraghavan, he was a professor sir, of such a renowned institute called Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. It is not even an easy task to enter into there. And that person, an accused of plagiarism, and whose copy he has, you know, used for his own publication, his own doctoral, you know, student, which is shame. And then finally, definitely, you understand that sometimes what happens, you know, just dismissing a person becomes a problem for the reputation of the institute also. Therefore, institutes in a quagmire, what to do? They're in a dilemma. They cannot throw them out, neither they can keep it. What happens finally, those kind will go slowly out of the limelight. And when they are going out of the limelight, then institute find a way how to, you know, turn them out. I am giving you interesting cases, okay? And that is very interesting cases because they are from international examples. One is John Darcy. John Darcy was working in Harvard University, okay? It is a 1981 case. And, you know, if you are at Harvard University, definitely you are an internationally recognized scholar. And he has been publishing, you know, scholarly papers regularly in various international journals across the world. And definitely anybody from Harvard University submits a paper, who will dare to refuse it? So he was, you know, getting it published. And he was so generous, he got it published by making his senior boss as co-authors, his students as co-authors, his other colleagues as co-author. So therefore, everybody around him were happy with him. And he got one after another publications. And he was so recognized that he got a, you know, personal project of $3 billion. Now that time, some of his close colleagues, they started inquiring into it. And they found that all his publications are nothing but copying from somewhere, changing a bit, changing the, you know, what you call title, subtitle, structure, and republishing it in various academic journals. And those who can really look into it, they are all, you know, what you call shut up by making them co-authors. So everybody was, you know, assisted, helped to get a recognition. Therefore, everybody is silent. So this silencing procedure then challenged, and you understand that Harvard University could not throw him out. And his boss was absolutely unaware of it. What a, you know, critical situation at that time. Next, I'm giving a, you know, another thing, one Vijay Soman from Kerala. He went all the way, he's a doctor, MBBS doctor, and then he all the way went to Yale University for his father's study. And he was studying, and his boss was a very renowned person. He used to get, you know, articles submitted in different medical journals for a comment before publications, because peer review journals. So one of the articles came from one that came to him, and he passed it over to Vijay Soman, and then Vijay Soman rejected it, saying that it is not publishable document. After 3 more months gone, then Vijay Soman sends a paper, okay, with his, you know, boss's name as a co-author, and that goes to another, you know, what will, Helena's paper come to American Journal of Medicine. And Vijay's paper goes to, you know, England, UK's Journal of Medicine. Now, UK Journal of Medicine, by the time, okay, passes it over to the same Helena Rotard for a review. Helena finds, it is my article. It was rejected by somebody. Okay, now how come it is going to be published? So he notified it to the journal, and it was came that Vijay Soman was plagiarizing or trying to plagiarize. And you understand that what an embarrassment for his institute, Yale University, and his senior. Now, so this has been happening actually regularly in a routinely in various institutes. I'm taking you to this situation like COVID-19. In last 3 months, all of you are flooded in social media, WhatsApp, with plenty of medicines. From Ayurvedic to medicine to yoga, everything you got, and from Tulsi to Haldi to anything. Now, most of them you might have, and most of them you might have deleted. Now, imagine, these came from social media from your colleague and friend. They are mostly fake.
because COVID-19 medicine is yet to be discovered. So therefore, they are definitely fake. Now, you imagine that a person like Trehan, Dr. Trehan, or AIMS director, okay, that kind of person is publishing a journal in Lancet or some great medical journal and giving a prescription that you, for COVID-19, you take this precaution. What you will do? You will believe it. You will try to practice it. And since it may not be a medicine, you may even, lose your life. So this is called an ethical thing. Unless you are sure, unless you are scientific, please avoid publishing something because it may become very, very detrimental. So, it is not only that who is projecting, but how it has been presented. Now, if you are giving a lot of graphs, a lot of statistical data, then it becomes more convincing. Okay, so therefore, presentation also can be, problem. Now, what is ethics all about? Ethics about, it is about regulation. And can I just get my, PPT document here? Can just admit, help me. Can I get?
Sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. Sir, your screen, there is the green button. It's called share content.
Share content.
You just go over there.
Okay, then. No, it is in my recall. It is in my pen drive, so I can just open it.
Okay. You should just open it on your screen.
But where is pen drive is coming? It is here. Okay.
Yeah, it's done, sir. Now you open your file.
But it is not giving access to folder. Why not? Is not opening. Folder is not responding.
My side, sir, platform is working.
If your computer is just I cannot get to my file. That is what I am thinking. Why I am not?
Okay.
See, this folder is not opening. Once folder opens, can I just reduce it? No, that is also not working. Oh God, it's a problem. Anyway, it doesn't help. No, not all are inactive now. Okay, so informal, now when you are doing an informal research, you are doing it on your own. Okay, so therefore,
sir, sorry to disturb. Either you just share your screen or stop the screen sharing so your video will come up.
How to stop sharing? Not share. So what to do? Not. Nothing. Right? It's not giving anything to do.
You just cross that and open your video, sir. It will be okay.
Video.
Yes, sir. No, it's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Now, when you are, going for a research by your own, it is individual research. So, when you are doing individual research, then definitely you can work out your own framework. You can your own mission, own objective. But when you are in institutional environment, protection varies much more because your research paper, research guideline, research objective, everything will be done according to the rules and regulation of the institute. And that institute, being a legal institute, it cannot do something illegal and unethical. So therefore, in an institutional environment, the possibility of making more, ethical research is better than individual effort. That doesn't mean that an individual effort cannot make an ethical research. Now, when you are knowing this ethical research, okay, what you, okay, you read a lot of, you know, materials, you go to the library, okay, definitely you have to do, and you will earn knowledge, you will earn insight, then you will be developing your research paper. Now, if your motive is to do cut and paste, then what you will do, you will try to be always, you know, careful that your plagiarism should not be detected. So always you try to hide it. Now what happens? There are plenty of, you know, what you call plagiarism detection software also, it is cross-check, authenticate, you know, a lot of them are all around. And there is particularly a plagiarism checking center by an organization called COPE in America. So they have a soft, you know, what you call a website which regularly does it for the scholars across the world and institutes across the world. Okay. So therefore they do it. Now, when you are doing ethical research, what you will do, you will study, then based on that, you will improve your information set, you will inform, you know, based on, you will change your language, you will strengthen your referencing system, you will, you know, make your sources of information more authenticated, and, you know, you will use various kind of analysis and framework which is, you know, going to a particular objective or meeting a particular objective. So this is how you will be moving around. Now, when you are doing it, okay, who is coming to your rescue for, you know, especially a library, which is coming to your rescue? Because you are going to a library, and in that library, okay, you are doing all this kind of research work. Now, Copyright Act comes here as your rescuer. Now, 1957, we had first Copyright Act, we all know about it. After that, that is, you know, 1957, that's a different world. Now, 1957 to, you know, 2000, I would say, is a, you know, this 43 years is a different world, because this is the time when internet came, when digitization came, when WTO came, when IPR regime came. Due to that, now that 1957 Copyright Act became, you know, faced problem. And they could not solve many of these problems. So therefore, 1995, when TRIPS were introduced after WTO was introduced in 1994, Government of India tried to amend Copyright Act again and again. But finally, in 2012, they could make a major Copyright Amendment Act. Now, I'm not going in detail about that Copyright Act, because you know that in every seminar we discuss about it. But 2012, when it was amended, and 2013, when it was enforced. Now, in this period, that is from 1957 to 2013, which is around 53, 55 years period, that time India entered into digitization. Now, 2012's main area was to, you know, introduce digitization. Because of the digitization, now many things can be copied, many things can be converted. Now, you know, everything that we are doing, it becomes a copyright violation. So a copyright violation in the present era was becoming a roadblock for your progress, progress of your individual life, progress of the national life. So 2012 Copyright Act came to admit digital rights management. That means now a library can store not only hard data, but also soft data. Now, when you are entering into the soft data, the scope of data manipulation, scope of data conversion is much more. And a library system really cannot always, you know, look into these areas. Now, they will be always creating the platform so that research, you know, activities moves forward. But now this whole, you know, what do you call, checking system, you have to come, that whether plagiarism is taking place or not, because plagiarism means everybody who is in the chain will be somewhere other will be accused. So that is how the whole link is. Now they started, you know, digital rights management. If you may see that now, if you download something, at the bottom of your computer, your IP address appears. So that means from which computer you are doing, from which location, which city you are doing, now they are trying to locate it. This is called DRM management. At the same time, in a library, you are trying to see that whatever in, you know, free version is available, PDF version is available, let this go to the researchers and scholars. So this two-way tension has been going on. One way is that how to keep a watch over you, and another way, how to make more information more easily, more conveniently available to the researchers and scholars. So therefore, library comes in between as a major bridge, major connecting point between the research publication and research. Now, when recall, your ethical errors can be less when there is a supervisor guide, when there is a peer review system, when there is whatever you are publishing, okay, that publishing goes through a systematic pattern. So there is a person called Michel Foucault. He's a postmodernist. He said once that library is never thing that is merely inert, a stock of book, okay, but it is actually a place where every day a text is reinterpreted, re-explained. So same Gandhi might be 20 scholars who have read the same book has understood Gandhi in a different way, interpreted Gandhi in a different way, and used Gandhi in a different way in their scholarly exercise. So that is what Michel Foucault said. In a library, text is re-explained, reinterpreted every day. And through this re-explanation and reinterpretation, actually every day in a library, a new knowledge is born. And therefore, library is can be recognized as the temple for the academics. Now, in Copyright Act 2013, what it does, it says that when you are converting, earlier if you are converting, it becomes a copyright violation. For supposing that there is a sculpture, okay, somebody has done a sculpture, stone sculpture, and you are interpreting it, okay, and then making a sketch, and then making a video and publishing it, and therefore that becomes a copyright violation. Now, this 2013, it says that this conversion is definitely possible and it is not a copyright violation. But the first person who has created the sculpture, he is the first owner of the copyright. So therefore, I am the owner of the copyright, only the version that I have created, but original version still remains. So this originality of the copyright ownership, that is a great contribution of 2013 copyright. And this thing, because today you have seen that we are downloading, we are uploading, all is possible because Copyright Act 2012 has given those kind of possibility, those kind of flexibility and convenience. When you are going for this copyright violation, so as I said that library has a big role to play. And in a library environment and do it. Now, why then we'll be so scared about it? When you're accusing somebody, that is where my occupational role comes. When you are accusing somebody, don't you think that we have to see whether that person has done for commercial purpose or that person is a scholar? Okay, now taking a scholar and student to the court, don't you think it is too much? Or he may be a professor, he may be an academic person who just wants one publication to be, to appear in one of the journals so that he can get some credit. Okay. And you may see that it is a great person like V.S. Rajput or Deepak Penta who have got everything, but he wants little more credit, or a person like John Darcy who wants 3 billion grand, then it is a major violation. So therefore, the major violation and minor violation must be differentiated. Now, this is why in ethical sense, there is called gross ethical violation and minor violation. Now, when it is gross ethical violation, when you are doing racial discrimination, when you are giving gender biases, when your publication is showing your caste biases, religious biases, national chauvinism, then definitely, you are in a gross violation. And minor violation, you have copied little bit, up to 30-40%, why are you so much worried? So this can be done, but at least you go application. But why we feel, you know, so much indulging in copyright, or you call in cast and paste? Because our schooling system is wrong. You know, this reading is one domain and writing is another domain. If you all remember, we have read only, you know, our schooling system only reading, memorizing, and vomiting in the exam paper. Really, creative writing is not in our methodology. Unless creative writing regularly, you know, becomes 50% of our schooling system, then this copyright violation will be very difficult to remove from the, you know, what you call country. Because it is, you know, ethical issue is not something which can be controlled by law. Ethical sense, something which can be done by inculcating more sense of value, more sense of morality, more sense of principle. And that has to be done at the early stage of schooling. You make them to write, regularly, present, you know, regularly, then they will be comfortable with it. So therefore, you know, in our schooling system, there has to be some more attention on these copyright issues. Now I am giving you, you know, four types of copyright violation. One copyright violation we all do, which is cut and paste, cut and paste. We all have done sometime, we cannot just deny it. But there is another thing which is called ghostwriting. Ghostwriting is surrogated mother kind of thing. Okay. So somebody is putting it in the womb and you are becoming mother and father. Okay. So the surrogation, how it takes place, that actual somebody is writing, and the person whose name is appearing in the publication, he is only paying money to this writer. So the writer actually is never known. Okay. Writer remains, you know, outside the picture. And the person who is getting credit, he does not have the capability to produce a writer. He is just purchasing different articles from different, it's called ghostwriting. Then Claude, you know, what you call salam slicing. Salam, S-A-L-A-M, slicing. Okay, just piecing. Okay, cutting into pieces. So you got an article, you got a book. Okay, and then you used it in 10 different articles. Same matter, you have manipulated it and used in 10. This is called salam slicing. Or you have used some portions of it, not the entire thing, in your article. That salam slicing is a very, very regular practice. Okay. And then another thing is that you are writing, okay, by you know, making them almost a compulsion to write for you. Okay. So not ghostwriting, but under some, you know, compulsion or something they are writing. So this is where really takes place. Now, there is, I find personally feel there is not, you know, no need to be too much worried about what is copied, how much is copied. A little bit of copying will be always done, but that is not so dangerous. But definitely, we should develop more capacity to write on our own, to write, you know, creatively. And creative writing should be a practice. We must ask our, you know, children to write regularly. You know, creativity can also help them in developing our writing skill. Now, there is a book, okay, which I am ending now. That is one by William Board and others. They published it in 1985. That is called Betrayal of Truth. In that book, they have shown that even Galileo, the great, you know, scientist, even he did a little bit of manipulation, okay, data manipulation, to establish his, you know, truth. Okay, he different way manipulated at present. So therefore, it is in your own name. Newton, great scientist, Newton used to fudge data regularly to convince others that his prediction about, you know, all these things that he has done, gravitational powers and many other things, were correct. Okay, so therefore fudging data was done by Newton also. Then Mendel, who is known as the father of genetics, many of the Mendel's data have been, George Mendel, have been challenged later on, okay, by people saying that he actually manipulated data. So therefore, even after doing this, if those people can survive, then, you know, some mediocre or substandard level, you know, scholars can definitely survive. But only issue is that ethically, whether I want to be a substandard or, you know, a scholar who will be laughed at behind the back. So that is my own ethical issue. But, you know, it will definitely not spoil one's character or one career. But what I will expect that everybody will take care of their writing, these ethical issues, so that, you know, others, you know, find that, yes, I have learned something. What a language, what a presentation, what a nice analysis. So unless somebody does the wow, then what is the benefit of giving effort and getting a publication? Thank you very much for giving me, sharing my thoughts.
Thank you, Dr. Chakravarti. Now I open the, basically chat box, open the platform for the participant to ask a question, but I hope the session is itself very informative, so no one putting any question in the chat box, and if there is something, you can also see and you can answer accordingly. So again, sir, thank you very much to nicely basically present and teach us basically. You are the academician, you are the faculty member, so you explain very well the copyright issue and the relevance of the library. So I think most of the participants are from library science background and they understand very well. So thank you so much, Dr. Chakravarti. And at the end we do have some announcement. So calling to Salik Chandji for the formal vote of thanks. So I do have some announcement to announce the things. So in relevance of the Indo-China, what the solution is there. So from today onwards, we are not going to use Zoom platform for our webinar. That's a short. From Library Professional Association, we are not using the Zoom platform for any further webinar. So that is the main announcement. Another, for our next webinar, I open the platform to all the participants. You suggest, you demand what topic you want to discuss, what topic you want to learn. So accordingly, we just identify the speaker and we organize our next webinar. So. And apart from that, always we get a lot of queries for the certificate. So definitely, as per our mechanism, those who are the pre-registered and though paid for the certificate, definitely they will get the certificate within 2 days. And of course, I know it's a very 2 hours past. So if it is the physical seminar we are conducting, then definitely we offer you the very nice tea and coffee. And at the end of the session, definitely we offer you the fantastic lunch. But now we, every person, we are at our own home. So I request you to, you just enjoy your coffee and lunch with your family, with your loving family. So nice to be here. So I request Mr. Salik Chandji, he'll come and give the formal vote of thanks for our speakers and for today's session. Mr. Salik Chandji. Alex G, you are there? Hello. Okay. I think he is not connected right now. So thank you so much. Chakravarti sir, doctor. Thank you so much. And all our esteemed participants. Without you, the program is not possible, but there is your love for love and dedication towards the Library Professional Association. And we conducted this program and in association with the Society for Information Research and Society for Development and People's Action. So thank you both the organization to be here. Thank you so much, sir. Have a nice day.
Thank you.